Helen, tell me about love. What's love?
Wait a minute. He's always asking the questions.
Why are you asking the questions? Ask a question of someone. Me?
Bri, tell me about love. Because you practice it every single day in everything you do. So tell me how you see it.
Well, I actually see that love actually starts with loving yourself. And if you don't love yourself, it's a problem. Actually, you're the one who told me this, because I was all love, 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 love. And you said, no, you know, you've got to really look inside of yourself first. You can't just love externally. You've got to look internally and balance that first. Because I was talking about do unto others. And you said, if you don't love yourself, you will do unto someone else before they do unto you. You'll steal their glory. You'll poke out their eye. You know, and an eye for an eye makes everybody blind. So if you hate yourself, you'll hate other people. But when you really, really love yourself, you love all. And then that actually goes between each individual, and it goes also between ourselves and all the energy of all creation. Could be the animals, could be the plants, and it's giving thanks for all, even the problems. So when true love is loving even the problems, even the devil, even the thing that teaches you the lesson, because we learn lessons from those things. And so the trick is, when we start loving, thank you for being the biggest problem I've ever had, because now I know never to go down that alleyway again and create that same problem, because we ultimately create our own problems. So love comes from loving all.
Yeah, and actually, I think I also look at love as our capital, our currency. For example, it's a very interesting currency. The more you spend, the more you give, the more you get back automatically. And also, for example, you get it back because love comes from inside to the out, and that's when you really feel it. You don't always really feel it when somebody's putting it in, like saying, I love you, or something. You're feeling it even more when it's coming out of you to love something else. That's when you feel this bliss. You know, it's an extreme bliss when you're pouring compassion and pouring love out. So the thing is, we also have as much of it by measure of how much that we give out and how much that we exercise it. It's something to be exercised. Now, in these times, I just came back from Mexico, I'm noticing how many children are being bombarded with negative thoughts, negative ideas, and we actually decided to go and plant a giant, open a portal of hope and open a portal of love right in the middle of Mexico City. So the thing is, why? Because we need to exercise it. We need to see it more visibly. It cannot be individualistic. As much as you're in love with spirit, as much as you're in love with nature, love really magnifies when it's in relationship to something and to someone. So that's why it's about unity. And let's take it with you. What's happening with unity now and people coming together?
Add a tiny little bit to that, which is when they put you in jail and they put you in solitary confinement, you don't have any relationship to anybody and you literally go crazy or die.
That's the point in that case.
We have to have relationship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Sorry.
Mm-hmm. Perfect.
Yeah.
Analogy.
Yeah, no, I mean, we need each other. I feel like we're at a really major place where, you know, it's no longer about, you know, we're breaking down these barriers of who we are and where we come from and all these things that we do to, like, identify ourselves, these archetypes of, oh, I'm from Northern America, I'm from South America, I'm a doctor, I'm an artist, or, you know, whatever it is. It's all that's going out the window. And it's really about letting these walls and these bridges fall down so we can start to really just see each other as one and see that, you know, we all have the same body. You know, I mean, maybe some of us are born with, you know, some things going on that might be a little bit different, but ultimately at the core, we all have the same body. You know, we all come from the same place. And seeing that, you know, holding on to your ideals about, you know, what you were taught or what you grew up with doesn't, you know, that's not healing, you know, like that doesn't bring people together. And I think forgiveness is really the key for us all coming together, because, you know, it's not about ripping away other people's belief systems or anything like that, but it's really about, you know, seeing and accepting where we all come from, but seeing that we all are the same and that we are one, and no longer putting up those barriers in our mind, because it's, you know, it's all an illusion. We have to just really change our minds, and we're the ones who create our enemies, and we're the ones who can love and forgive our enemies. So that's, I don't know, for me, forgiveness has been one of the major keys.
And you have to start by forgiving yourself.
Yes.
That's part of going back to the self.
Yes.
And so you were talking last night, as above, so below.
Mm-hmm.
Macro, micro, it's the same thing.
As is within, as without.
If we want to save the world, or we want to create peace in the world, create peace here. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you want to create peace in the world, start with you and then all of your relationships. Create peace there.
Mm-hmm.
And then once you create that peace, create peace within your community,
mm-hmm.
you know, your tribe. And then the town, then the county, then the state, then the country. And so it goes out.
Mm-hmm.
But it radiates from your heart.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, and that's what the elders who I work with, you know, that's what they've taught me, is that, you know, ultimately, we have to find that within ourselves. And it's a natural part of the process to have, you know, like the horrible times and to be really down and to just feel the weight of the world. I mean, that's a natural process. That's a part of life. You have the ups and you have the downs, but it's really about knowing how to get yourself out of that, and that there's so much beauty and there's so much light and there's so much just love and coming out of the darkness and going through those places. It's just about creating that equilibrium. And people think, oh, it's gonna be, you know, all bad, or it's gonna be all good. You know, it's like, come on, mm-hmm. you know, that's not what it's about. And we're just, I feel like we're just leaving this whole crazy.
Balance.
Yeah, there's balance in the middle. And
But what I said earlier, you know, good or bad, you can get a place to a place of love where you love even the bad.
Yeah.
So then it is all good.
But who's to say what is bad?
Yeah.
Well, your problems. See, we have a tendency to hate our problems because they slow us down or stop us from what I want. But really, where problems sometimes bring you what you need, which is a good kick in the ass or whatever, or to no longer be an alcoholic. The problem, you know, stops you from being an idiot, you know, or teaches you how to go another path and grow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point when you start loving your problems, thank you for being the worst relationship I've ever had in my life, because now I know never to date an alcoholic or a heroin addict. Okay. Mm-hmm. So now I won't do that again, you know. Mm-hmm. So there, you know, and then you don't, or you see the signs, another heroin addict comes at you and you say, no, thank you, I've had enough.
Well, it is like what you always say about repeat. When you repeat something, it's insanity,
mm-hmm.
you know? So if you don't learn from your mistakes, you don't learn from the things that keep showing up in your life, and you're like, why do I keep doing this? Why do I, you know, I found myself doing that. I'm like, why am I continuing to do things that are, you know, maybe hurting myself or whatever it is? And then I'm like, this is insane, you know? This
but is part of that is a phase, because mm-hmm. I've seen, you know, there's no such thing, mm-hmm. no such thing as stagnation or doing nothing. Like somebody can say, well, I'm not doing anything about that in my life, or I'm not, there's no such thing.
Mm-hmm.
There's constant movement. Now we are lean, constant movement in the four directions.
Only constant is change.
Okay, mm-hmm. So what happens? It's in a spiral. Mm-hmm. There's no such thing as coming around in a perfect circle to the exact same thing. That doesn't exist either.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's going around in a spiral. When we're totally conscious
mm-hmm.
that we live in this spiral and we move and grow in a spiral, at every second we can be aware, is my spiral starting to spiral downhill? Or is it starting mm-hmm. to spiral uphill? Sometimes people say, oh, I thought I was done with that. I thought I was done with dating a neurotic, whatever, and I thought you'd be different. No, maybe you did come back to that same point, but from another viewpoint. Because now you're at that same point, you're back to dating with a neurotic person. But wow, now you came to it from a higher point of view in your own development. Now you're aware of it from the very beginning. Buck. You know, you see it right then. If you were spiraling downwards into that pattern, you probably would come right back to it, but in a much harsher way and wouldn't even be aware of it. So it's all about consciousness and awareness in our travels through the spiral. Yes, mm-hmm. we may come back to the same point again because there's little measures and markers, mm-hmm. but we came back to it like, oh, I remember this, okay. Yeah, I stopped it in time to definitely move on. And the next time you come back, it's like, oh, I remember when. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a whole other feeling. It reminds you, it keeps you remembering where you were and what you're doing, where you're going. But if we're just aware that at all times we're managing our development, like Alec Lewis said, everything you do is a vote for or against our future. That's how the youth feel it, as far as our actions environmentally. Mm-hmm. But as far as human beings, every action is for or against my movement in the spiral in the direction we're going. Now, I personally, my spiral, I wanted to go downwards, but for different reasons. I came to the earth to bring light into. So I've gone into great depths of human condition, mm-hmm. purposely, because that's where I feel that bringing the light is what's the use of enlightening or bringing light or sharing light like a medicine, acupuncture, you go deep into where that point is and you bring that light and boom, all of a sudden the whole system lights up. You know, that's my idea. Go deep mm-hmm. into the darkness. Go deep into where the supposed problem is that oftentimes in one moment, whoa, I woke up from a spell, what happened? That's not how it was supposed to be. Mm-hmm. And people's lives can be totally altered in one moment.
You really see your shadow.
Not by anything that I did, but by them simply on their own seeing their own light. Mm-hmm. Seeing their own light.
From the point of the shadow.
From the point of the shadow. Mm. And going, wow, is that the real me?
Yeah, because so often we just think, oh, we're just so perfect. And all our friends know that, no, you have a zit on your face right over there, but we can't see it because we can't see the zit. You know? We can't see that we've got habits and whatever that are unhealthy. We're just in our little routine or pattern. And the trick is to break out of the pattern. And if you don't see the pattern, you can't break out of it. Mm-hmm. So Alcoholics Anonymous, isn't it like the first step of realizing you're an alcoholic? Mm-hmm. You know, the trick is with the shadow is realizing you've got a shadow, you know, mm-hmm. realizing you got a problem. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have relationships, because the relationships, a true friend will say, look, you know, the color you wear doesn't work for you. Your hairstyle looks ridiculous, or your whatever, you know, or that behavior is mm-hmm. unbecoming of you. You're better than that. Or mm-hmm.
yeah, well, taking it from there, yeah. For example, I know that the 12-step program is extraordinary. It's saved mm-hmm. thousands of lives. But taking it to a different level on the spiral, mm-hmm. what would happen if instead of saying, oh, I'm an alcoholic, my name is Jane, and I'm an alcoholic for 40 years now. Mm-hmm. Instead of that, saying, I'm a healthy person.
Mm-hmm. I love myself.
I'm a beautiful soul.
I yeah. love myself, and I have fun serving mm-hmm. others.
Why not take it to another level now that our spiral is showing us other ways of using language and other ways of in our attachment to the word, I'm an alcoholic. Like, I'm not saying it is a perfect program for so many, but why not, if we're spiraling into other ways, neurolinguistic programming, mm-hmm. using it differently, like, I'm a healthy, happy person, or mm-hmm. Because that's the one you want to be in touch with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not the constant reminder of that place you're stuck in. You know, it's just an idea that, you know.
It's a good idea.
How do we overcome our fears? Fearlessness is actually key. They say love and fear are the opposites. That fear is the lack of love.
Okay.
And so how do we overcome our fears that everybody's been having? How do you move beyond?
See, you're touching on a very, because having stepped into a situation, and, you know, I just went back home, and where's home? Mexico is home. Mm-hmm. I always remember the Mexicans as, oh, somebody died, and out come all the death jokes. Mm-hmm. And, oh, you know, you're going to die. I mean, some horrible tragedy happened. Before the news hits the streets, there's jokes about it. Okay, so that's a way that culture has constantly dealt with tragedy and stuff like that, with humor and everything else. There's so much fear peddling right now, so much horror and fear peddling through the media, through the news, through that people are eating it up. They're like, I need my fear doses today, and they're sharing it, and they're passing it on to the children, and I'm wondering, how far away from seeking a better life can we go that we're spending more time seeking bad news on television, literally on radio, television, it's on all day long. Oh, three people decapitated. Oh, no, no. How far are we going out of our way to seek mm-hmm. and eat fear is our nutrition, to nourish mm-hmm. ourselves with fear. Mm-hmm. You know, if I am starting to feel that I have so much to be grateful for, so much to love, so much to share, all of a sudden there's no room for fear. It's like it starts getting crowded out of the place. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, and so we have to start exercising joy, exercising hope. You know, there are things that you practice, you exercise, you mm-hmm. become aware of. Mm-hmm. And see, right now I'm really on a campaign of going in the midst of the most horrific situations and popping up, like I said, portals of hope and happiness. And when people see this, like, I remember that. I remember happiness. I remember when children were laughing. Mm-hmm. You know, and they're starting to say, hey, that's the place I want to be in.
Mm-hmm.
And we can be there every moment of every day.
Mm-hmm.
But again, we just have to remember. Choose.
You know, we've been so programmed. I don't think people are conscious that they're totally addicted to fear, addicted to the television, you know, saying, I just got to get my news in. Well, but it's not news, you know, it's the same thing. It's like a broken record playing again and again. And so, you know, I think we have to be very discerning about where we get our information from and how much of it we get, you know, and like you want to be informed, you know, but you don't want to be inundated with all the stuff that's out there because they're throwing so much at you, you know.
Wait, where are you being informed? Because if somebody tells you five people died, what kind of great information am I receiving that will help my life?
No, none. You're right.
What?
Mm-hmm.
What is newsworthy to my lifestyle? For, you know, we have mm-hmm. to do exactly what you say. We have mm-hmm. to discern.
I believe all of humanity has three basic fears. And you know how we have our mind, our body, and then our spirit? Well, they're related to that. Our body is the first one that I would say, fear of death. Oh. And so people cling on to fear of death. Don't cross the street, you might kill yourself. Don't do that, you might, you know. It always goes into fear related to you're going to die, you're going to poke your eye out, you're going to... So it's always body, but it starts with the fear of death or the end of our lives, and that prevents us from living. The next one would be our mental fears, which usually our mental and ego and mind is related to power. Mm-hmm. And whatever we call our power, it could be you relate that your power is being a mother, your power is being a businessman or CEO, or your power is being a scientist or an astronaut or whatever. You know, mm-hmm. When you meet someone, you say, "Hi, you know, my name is Brian. I'm a blah," whatever that blah mm-hmm. is, that's the mental version of power. Mm-hmm. And losing our power as we get older or our job gets taken away from us, our CEO gets downsized. Well, when we lose that, that's the next fear you have. And quite often on the other side of that is you lose your job and you realize, oh, this was great. Now I can go be who I want to be instead of who my ego wanted to be. My spirit wants to be. So our third one is the spiritual fear.
But what do you say to a lot of the people who think, though, that their spiritual path is to be a CEO? I'm curious what you think about that.
Well, if they're ethically and morally doing it from a place of balance and harmony and unity and compassion and giving and nurturing and clear communication, that is a spiritual path. And you could be a spiritual garbage man. You don't have to be, you could be a spiritual CEO. You can be a spiritual leader in everything you do. You can be a spiritual singer. And you don't even have to call yourself doing spiritual music. You can do heavy metal or punk rock and do spiritual punk rock. It's everything we do and every step we take, spirituality isn't believing in God or some other thing, it's being kind. Mm-hmm. Dalai Lama says, my religion is kindness. Kindness. And Bob Marley and Ziggy Marley says, you know, my religion is love. Love is my religion. Love and kindness. I dig it. So if you have a kind, loving CEO that is conscious in every step of the business and leading from a place of true, genuine gratitude, mm-hmm. Now that is a spiritual CEO. Mm-hmm. So anyway, all that's ego, that's mind. Mm-hmm. So losing our power is that, and the next is not being, the spiritual one would be not being loved, giving love and not getting it back, or not being worthy of getting love. And that's our spiritual need. So love and power and death are our three biggest fears for all people. And all the other ones kind of sprinkle and mix up with many of those, like uses some, but our mental, spiritual, and physical fears are those three, sort of. And
but how many of those are you? I'll tell you why.
They're within all of
the
us.
The mind.
We are all.
The body,
when we say holy, we mean whole.
The body is a creature. It is not you. The body is part of the earth. The body is a little creature that you inhabit. And it is mortal. It knows it's mortal. But it has inside of its own body structure certain programming, fright, flight, blah, blah, blah. Those are natural things that come with it for a basic survival thing so that they don't, you know, burn themselves or there's a thing like that. But the body is not you. The body has a right to be afraid of death, in a sense, early death or whatever. Though creatures know they're going to die because they're part of the earth. It's part of the... But that's... the mind is HAL. It's like the computer. HAL out in space. Mm-hmm. HAL didn't want to die.
I think it might also be H-O-W, because your mind is always asking HAL.
Okay, but Hal didn't want to be extinguished, and Hal is the big ego. It's like ego. Mm-hmm. You know, ego is something that is not you. It's the mind's brain. It's only Hal speaking here. It's only Hal. Hal doesn't want to be extinguished either, but that's a mechanical Hal mind stuff. The real you, the only you, is spirit, and that's universal forever. It will never be extinguished. It may not be called Brian next time around. It may be called Guckaluckala. You know what I mean? But the point is, if we stay more in touch with the real I, there's less and less reason to fear.
I agree with that. Mm-hmm. I agree with that. Yeah, which is our spirit. That's love. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what I said, the last one was love. The spirit of love and kindness. That is, that's the inner core of what you're saying.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So seek love. Be kindness, and it starts with loving yourself.
And you could go any day, like you could go tomorrow. If you're living, there's the only point of exercising any of this is now.
Mm-hmm.
The, you know, so that's the only place you're really living.
I mean, not when you die and go to heaven or hell. You're not supposed to do it there.
There's no place to go.
We both have had near-death experiences.
Yeah.
And
me too.
So
there you go. Mm-hmm.
We've had this gift. We've had this gift of knowing something else. And when you die, could you explain
what information you get cured of fear, basically. You get really, I'm cured of fear.
Well, that's the thing. I always say the day.
Basically.
Fear of death, particularly.
Yeah.
Particularly. It's like, bring it on.
I highly recommend it, actually.
Yeah. Oh, I've almost died twice. I know it. It's like the day you become okay with death is the day you start living.
That's the deal. How many people are dying every single day out of sheer fear of maybe somebody will come bomb them or something?
Mm-hmm.
Well, and when you came back, you got a new experience with your relationship to energy, that we're all eternal energy, and that energy is related to what we'd all call God or love or whatever that relationship is, because growth comes from love. We have everybody on the planet has two choices, create or destroy, yum or yuck, grow or decay.
But destroy is part of creation.
Yes, every act of creation is an act of destruction, and every act of destruction is an act of creation.
Totally.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's part of the cycle, the yin and yang of life. Yeah, well, being on this planet in this mind, your mind, what it does is always comparing. You know, it doesn't know what white is until it sees...
So
dark,
just stick another software into HAL and run a different thing.
Our mind's always in comparison. That's why we have two eyes. That's why we have two ears, so we can locate with using comparison.
It's because HAL has to manage the ship. You're the ship. Your body's the ship.
Yeah.
So HAL needs to compare things. But
the real guide is the spirit, right?
The real guide is everything. Everything.
Mm-hmm.
But when we say whole, complete, and holy, it's all the same. I think holy ought to be spelled W-H-O-L-Y.
It probably was,
originally. Because mind, body, spirit, we are all whole. Mm-hmm. And we are all whole. We are all one. We are all related. Like, what is it? Lakota is called Metakuyasi.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Metakuyasi.
Which is, we are all related.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain the circle of... with Native Americans, the black, white, red, and yellow?
Okay, well, it's interesting because some people have it differently. You know, like some people have the yellow in one place, I mean the black in one place and the red.
Mm-hmm.
Mexicans, the Mexicas, they have blue. It's you know, they have different places.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really...
Instead of black. And green instead of black, I've also seen.
Yeah, but they. So the thing is, it's really your relationship to the universe from wherever you are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those kind of representing the four directions, many say the four races.
Mm-hmm.
Which is
the black people, the white people, the red people, the yellow
right.
people.
Right, and one's custodian of the air and the fire and in the water, you know.
And the four directions.
And the four directions.
Mm-hmm.
So that's only a reference as to where you are in the point of where your universe is evolving.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've seen many different, the Incas and the Lakotas, and they sit down and they talk about it, and there's there's a switch in the dials, but that's only because... Like, they have the Southern Cross they got themselves by, or, you know, there's You know what I'm trying to say? There's a whole different cosmology from wherever you're standing on Earth.
Yeah.
And that's the one you sing to, you have praise to, because that's the only place that you are coming from that you can pray from, you know? Mm-hmm. So that even that is not a fixed law, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, and you look at all the indigenous cultures, most of them all around the world, all have integrated the four directions. That's, you know, that's been the main premises of which they're guided by, you know, is earth, water, wind, fire.
And those elements have certain properties.
But those elements are the main elements that keep us alive.
Exactly.
And how is it possible we have so many university graduates, professors, professionals, how is it possible that they haven't received 1 hour of lessons on how to manage the four elements that keep us alive, of how to actually manage water, manage fire, manage heat in a way that's appropriate for sustainable livelihood and for humans to endure, to perdure, or whatever it is, to last. But the point is, that how come that kind of knowledge isn't in education?
It's coming back, though.
Yeah.
It is coming back. That's why people have chosen homeschool as opposed to the forced school.
I have a homeschool flag.
I would say that I'll never let school stand in the way of my education.
Yeah, there you go.
And I'm serious. It meant a lot to me to educate myself on top of it. And so now I'm just so excited that in this day and age, what we dreamt of when we were growing up was, you know, a little black box that we could just ask it any question. And it would give us an answer. Well, it's called the iPhone.
You had one of those,
or whatever, your smartphone. No, and we can just get on the internet and instantly find out any little question you'd ever want to have. I made a list of questions when I was 25 that I thought, before I die, I'd like all these answered. I bet you within the hour I can answer all 25 from Wikipedia. You know? Which I thought, before I die, well, shit, that's incredible that we can do it that fast. We are in an amazing time now.
Mm-hmm. Ah, yes, but what are we doing with this information?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And how are we sharing it? And, you know, what are we bringing forth? And
I think we're bringing forth a lot of garbage and a lot of amazing stuff all at the same time. Mm-hmm. Facebook has reconnected us, and we started this whole thing off about love and connections. Mm-hmm. It's brought us together to people that I've forgotten about. And they've shown up again, and I've had new old relationships, or old relationships rekindle. And then I'm on YouTube, and I find things I'm interested in, and find new bits of it, and I share it with new friends and get them interested in it. And overnight, instead of people watching some stupid soap opera or whatever, reality or non-reality TV or whatever they call that, they're actually watching YouTube and getting information that they would have gone to sleep with in school, but instead they're hungry for now.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
well, anyway, you're awesome at that. You know, putting that great stuff out there. Awesome.
Yeah, but you are
awesome.
Too. You know,
we can't underestimate. I really have so much faith in humanity. You know, I mean, I think people ultimately have pure hearts. You know, they are good beings, and you know that. When it's just about learning, you know, just about learning. Like, I don't think people sit around and recognize like the human consequences attached to everything. Like, even that bottle of water you just poured in there, you know, like how many lives had to die for the goods that I'm receiving, you know. And at the end of the day, we all want the same thing. We want a house, you know, roof over our head. My grandma always says, the key to life, you know, roof over your head, great friends, great family, and food. And it's what we all want, but like we've blown out this idea of what a roof over our head is, you know, and so then we have to work extremely hard to have, you know, this grandioso roof. And at the end of the day, it's still providing all the basic elements that we all want as human beings. And so I think really we're at this time where we have to just kind of stop and look and say, is it worth it? You know, is having, you know, the super, you know, having like the 5-car garage and, you know, this American lifestyle, this grandioso, extravagant way of living, is it really worth it? And And it's up to the person to ask that question.
What you really need is really the question.
Well, how many people are dying as a result of it?
Do you need the Ferrari? Yeah. Do you need the 10,000 square foot house? Do you need it?
Yeah.
Or do you really need better relationships?
Yeah. Well, and we just have to think about where our stuff comes from. It's so important. You know, it's just to say, okay, is there a way that we can do it better? You know, is there a way we can do it with more humanity? Is there a way we can do it ethically and not have to have so many people die to produce the energy that we need to produce the things that we are receiving in terms of our everyday life and the way that we live? And so just every time you touch something, I always just try to think about, like, where does it come from and who made this? And, you know, is the person who made this happy, and are they really feeling empowered in what they're doing? And a lot of, you know, so I don't know. I think if we just think about that, then we start to think about each other and, you know, just having that consciousness. You know, like, I'm not perfect. I'm a mass consumer in so many ways, but I think building that.
But we're all in process. I mean, I lived in an eco village for 15 years, and mm-hmm. you can never really say we are now officially a standard eco village.
Yeah.
It's always in process.
Yeah.
Always in process.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So, but at least if we're making efforts in different areas.
Yeah, just the awareness, having that awareness.
And everybody on the planet's muddling their way through life, like you just said. Mm-hmm. We're all learning. Dalai Lama is learning new lessons every day. And even though some people that worship him think that he's perfect, he's learning new lessons on aging, on impermanence, on relationships, because he's being challenged with every day going to a place with 8,000 people. And I guarantee you, he gets angry. And he has to, there are new lessons every moment of every day for him. It's exciting for him. Mm-hmm. New technology he's having to deal with. So everybody, even the most spiritual, have these, you know, stuff. The Pope, same thing. You know, everybody in relationship, it's all about finding our own new space at every moment and readjusting it. And once you learn a lesson, doesn't mean, oh, I've got it. I don't ever need to go back there again. I know that particular part of spirituality. No, you have to revisit it every moment and every step of every day.
Yeah, but like you're saying, this, for example, spirituality. I mean, okay, there's certain people, certain sadhus, that are out in the cave, and they've been in a cave, and they don't come down, and they don't come out, and, you know, people pull food over there, and they're very spiritual and everything. But, I mean, I'd like to see that same spiritual leader in the subway system in New York in rush hour. I think the people that are capable of extending a little gift of courtesy in the rush hour in New York subways,
mm-hmm.
is far higher development. It has a far more developed soul than somebody that is totally away from all of this and has the luxury of developing the purity of their mind, heart. Because the point is how to be spiritually compassionate in the midst of the madness. That's the real trick. That's when you really feel you're onto something, if you can find that part of you.
Mm-hmm. It's being able to love even when you're being kicked. Nelson Mandela did that. Remember his story is really pretty extraordinary. Mm-hmm. He was in prison getting beaten every day, and he realized to really create peace with these people who were just persecuting him, he had to create peace within himself. And so he just found within him the ability to have a strong, deep relationship and look into the eyes of his persecutor and say, John, you don't have to do that. I love you, John. And John, while John was beating him, he just kept with it, even though it hurt, and kept with it. It's okay, I love you. At some point, John couldn't beat him anymore, so they bring in Bill, and Bill would beat him, and he'd do the same thing. And after a while, all the guards loved him. Couldn't beat him anymore. So everything's contagious. The love we put out is contagious. If you want to smile, just give a smile, and then get it back. Mm-hmm. If you want to laugh, laugh, and then you'll get it back. And then you'll laugh even more. It's contagious. But if you want to hate and anger, it's contagious too.
That's the point.
Fear has been contagious. It's been the winner since 9/11. It's been contagious to be in fear. And this is awesome. It's a step in humanity going through this fear of all these different things and having us...
Well, it's created a lot.
Yeah. It's pretty exciting though. I think it is because through crisis, we learn. Every act of destruction is an act of creation. But, you know, we have two choices, create or destroy, but we also just have that ability to move beyond all that and seek the good.
Well,
I think
everybody's talking about creating peace and looking for peace and everything. I personally, I've stopped using the word peace as one of my goals because I feel we need 100 years of respect.
Yes.
We can't even... Peace should be a gift that you can mention after you've lived a life of respecting people. Then you can say, I can talk about peace. Peace is like a smokescreen. Oh, we went, we said a prayer, okay, put some waves out in there, wonderful. And then we go and we are driving crazy and we want to run somebody over because we're in a rush to get to the peace gathering. It's like... We have to have 100 years of respecting life, respecting our gifts that we have from nature, respecting our own personal gifts, I mean, as our body, respecting the living sentient beings and respecting others. Then peace will be the crop. The first crop of peace will come after 100 years of respect.
What is the very biggest, I guess what you'd call a principle of the Hopi people that you've seen? When you've heard them talk, what do they talk about? And when they talk about their relationship to the world, they talk about respect. Respect.
Oh yeah, respect, yeah.
I hear them all the time mention respect. Yeah. That is central and core.
That's right there.
To all of
that's
life.
That's the clue right there.
All of life.
Yeah,
all
that's
of the
it right
and
there.
It matters.
Because that in itself creates peace. That in itself creates, like you said, it becomes contagious. That in itself creates balance, like I'm being respected.
And kindness and love.
And kindness. And now I can return this. I can feel, I can blossom. I don't have to be defensive, you know.
Just a little bit. Just a little bit. R-E-S-P-E-C-T.
Now, what would you guys say that you...
I think... Yeah,
go What ahead, would you guys say that you've seen throughout your experience, and me and Helen working with the youth so much, what would you say... What new are you seeing from this generation of youth?
This very generation?
Mm-hmm.
I think they're coming in with a great sense of, okay, I see a lot going on that needs to be fixed. I'm going to fix it. I'm going to start right now. As a youth, I'm going to start going out there, inspiring people to make changes. You know, there's no way that the youth can be as fatalistic as adults. You know, that's part. And also the youth are at that particular age. Every major, major shift in humanity has happened when the youth are moving something different to another level. You know. In masses, like the youth now really get it that they have to do something and they have to do it now. So people are going, yeah, okay, let's go, we'll help you, or you know, or they challenge the old way of thinking, like why would they put pesticides in a park where children are playing? You know, they dare challenge that. They're not sold out, they're not, you know, indebted, they don't have to worry about it. They just say, hey, let's think as humans who want to be developing themselves in a healthy manner. You know, let's stop doing this and that. So they're addressing all these issues and they're inspiring people. And I feel that this new wave is really coming about just recently, you know.
I actually believe that what she's saying is 100% correct, that we have these extraordinary kids that are just pushing beyond where any of us could ever
imagine. But they got it. It's like they have the chip. It's like ticking.
And that all came partially because of just the evolution of the creatures that we are, you know, in the way we teach and learn, but the skills of the computer and all the information coming so fast that... What we used to have to go to the library on a Saturday and read a million books to try to find one little bit of information, they can get in a matter of seconds. So the information's hitting them faster, and that includes not only just a little picture on a book, but masses of videos and real live things and audio and so on. So they're getting so much bombarded information that that's awesome. Now, I see the opposite also going true, that... It's so much information's hitting some of these people that they're just like dumbed down, and all they want to do is play video games and about war and watch stupid stuff and that's also insane. So some people are using that technology and knowledge and information for awesome, incredible good, and some are using it for just ignorance.
There is a polarization going on.
It's a choice, and at some point, hopefully. The ignorance will switch over. And what it is, you know, we have a choice of create or destroy. Now, the same thing with anything within all of us or all of humanity, that love creates and hate destroys or fear destroys or whatever. And so some of those people are addicted to playing negative video games, war and whatever, and they're in that little loop. Well, they, in that moment, can shift and realize to switch to the other.
Speaking about that, I'm supposed to take my kids to go hug trees.
Oh. Well, you know, one thing I have to ask
you gotta get going
before you
that.
Guys go. Okay.
I just remembered when you said that. They're probably playing games
instead
till
of video,
I get
they're
there.
They're probably playing video games right now. Whoops, we're sorry, kids. We're sorry, guys.
Now, what... Have you guys seen, and did you notice that, like, let's say kids that maybe grew up with more materialism, per se, now are going back to the earth, where maybe those who didn't grow up with, you know, who didn't grow up with as much material are now trying to still play out, going toward all that materialism? You know, they're still trying to chase that dream that their parents were told, maybe. I mean, what are you seeing? Or are you just seeing it's a mass awakening? You know, what?
Well, there's two levels to that. One is we don't really make a change within ourselves until we're sick and tired of being sick and tired.
There you go.
But yet we also follow the sheep. And like I said, the fear has been contagious from 9/11. Well, I think the love can be contagious from now. And it is. And all of humanity needed to sit in that fear for a little while for the past 10 years. And now we're sick and tired of being sick and tired of fear. And we're all ready to go, vleep, I love you. And supposedly, in the moment of 9/11, New York, which is not really much of a relationship town as far as being kind and nice at every step of the way, it was like, give me a burger, give me a Coke, give me. It wasn't, thank you, could I order this? It was, give me. Well, supposedly after 9/11, for a few months or maybe a year or two, people changed to be much more kind, more loving, more in relationship, and seeing others as all. So maybe all this fear for 10 years, the steady diet of fear, will bring humanity into that bit sick and tired of being sick and tired.
There you go.
We're all going to love each other. And that's what Aquarius Age supposedly is. What's the song? This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius. Harmony and understanding.
Yay.
And we need to be in harmony. Kindness, love, unity. I love you.
Oh, Brian, you're so awesome.
All right.
Missy.
Are we done?
Yes.
All right.